Thank you, Prashant. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for this opportunity to come and speak with you. Just a one-minute introduction to Center Square Foundation. Center Square Foundation is a venture philanthropy and policy think tank focused on school education. We are really trying to be a catalyst for the best entrepreneurs, ideas, and tools to improve the quality of school education. So we've been around for about 5 years. So what we do is we do three things. We do grant funding, early stage grant funding. We do ecosystem building and research. And we do government advocacy. Over the last 4 or 5 years, we've funded about 25 organizations. We've tried to build platforms of philanthropy and experts around different issues. And on the government engagement side, we engage extensively with the central government, including the MHRD, the Niti Aayog, and about four to six state governments. Wanted to today really share some of our I'm going to try and do two things. One is share some broad trends which we are finding, which I think have an important implication from a regulatory perspective for all private schools. And the second thing I'm going to do is try and share some work that we've been doing along with one of our partners with the Center for Legal Policy around private school regulation. So I think kicking it off with regard to some of the trends which I think are important to recognize. The first is, I think, just the increasing participation enrollments of private schools. If you look at the data around private schools, even if you look at the DICE data, and you know, already K-12 school education, some 43% enrollment in the private sector. There's some states where enrollment has grown even more than 50%. Of course, this is not just a urban phenomena, this is a rural and urban phenomena. And you know, some people believe even these numbers are actually underestimated. I'll give you an example. From two states, Haryana and Andhra Pradesh, recently did a child level unique ID database, and they found that their enrollment, for example, in Haryana fell from 26 lakhs to about 21-22 lakhs. Similarly, in Andhra Pradesh, fell from about 76 lakhs to about 71-72 lakhs. So I can tell you that even based on these numbers, it could well be that we are well over 50% in some states. So I think the point I'm trying to make here is that look, there's private schools have reached a critical mass, and hence it's harder to be under the radar. I recently met an education secretary, and I was basically trying to push some reform ideas and really couch them as a way to boost government enrollments. So what he told me is, he said, look, which of these statements is correct? All children in schools and learning well, or all children in government schools? So he says, I believe in the former. He says, now, you know, I want the system to run. And, you know, if the private sector has an important role in that. So I think, look, again, so therefore, you know, it's size is, I think, an important dimension. Second thing, I think the focus of the system is coming on learning. And I know there's been a lot of talk, you know, from us last decade, there's a crisis in learning. But we're really seeing serious reform efforts in at least 5-6 state governments, and even in the central government, to improve learning. So in fact, I think many people may be aware that for the last 5 to 6 months, the central government has been busy trying to design and implement a census NAS, basically a census national achievement survey, whereby they want to test all children, all schools, grade 1 to 8 across the country. In fact, many states like Andhra Pradesh already for several years have been testing even private, you know, so they do this summative assessment and they share that same paper across all schools, government and private. So I think there's clearly, you know, if I was sitting on the private sector, on the side of private schools, clearly learning is likely to become more visible. Two, there's a lot of enhancement in tools. You know, so we have now, there's a lot of innovation happening on how to leverage technology for assessments, how to do it in a very efficient way. So I think really learning is something which one needs to really consider. Third, big trend is really the government capacity to capture data. We're finding that has grown significantly. So there are many states today where, so almost all state governments are building MI systems. They want to do it not only at the school level, but at the child level, link children to unique IDs. And actually already because of implementing Section 12(1C), several states like Rajasthan, MP, Odisha, have got now online data for all private schools in their state. And quite, if you go to, if you see Odisha put data online, which actually shows, you know, all the data they have with private schools, with regard to the teachers they have, with regard to the land they currently are based on. So clearly this whole, this points to that there's likely to be much more transparency and data available online with regard to the system. I think the reason we started to work in this space, you see these trends, but I think is that, look, these trends are both an opportunity as well as a threat for the private sector. And what we were finding was that there was a lot of knee-jerk reaction happening from the government. You know, a lot of parents in some school, in some states were protesting, and as a result of that, many states have starting to enact policies around fee regulation. So I think what we believe, and you know, we work on both strengthening the public system as well as the private system, but we believe on the private system, regulation is a very important lever. And that's when we actually partnered with Vidhi Center for Legal Policy. And our goal was really that can we develop a more structured approach to develop regulations. So the focus of our project was analyzing and improving private school regulations. And what we did is, so the first challenge we had was really, how do you even develop a framework to look at regulations? You know, regulations across states are not very clearly laid out. They're a combination of the school acts, RT legislation, judicial orders, government orders, very hard to unpack. So we said the first thing we need to do is really develop a framework on how we'll even analyze the private school regulation. So what we did is we looked at international frameworks, we looked at the World Bank Sabre framework, we looked at other sectors, and we finally came to the a framework that constituted three areas. We said we'll look at ease of opening a school, we look at operational autonomy, and we look at accountability and transparency. So we look at these three heads, and across these three heads, what we'll first start with is we analyze the as-is state. So we took some 5 to 6 states, and we started to analyze what are the as-is, what does private school regulation look like on an as-is basis, and then we will, based on that analysis, try and develop a model regulation regulatory framework. So give you some examples. So around opening a school. So opening a school, look, net-net, we found that, look, it is not easy to open private school, really largely because of very complicated process and very high sort of requirements. So even if, and I'm sure a lot of people in this room have faced this, but even if one looks at land norms, the minimum term of lease is not uniform across states. So for example, in Uttar Pradesh, you require a 10-year lease to actually get recognition. Haryana requires a 20-year lease. Similarly, some states are specifying the minimum area of land either on a per student basis, or some are saying you need a minimum quantity of land. So many states are taking a very, very different approach. If we look now, jump to the second area, operational autonomy. Again, here the general finding is that schools are constrained in their operations. So even if I look at two things, teacher hiring. So in Haryana and Karnataka, the recruitment of teachers is regulated by the presence of a government official in the selection panel. In Karnataka, the staff appointment patterns are prescribed by the government. Haryana and Karnataka are also two states which regulate the minimum salary that private schools must pay their teachers, unlike many other states, these two states. And of course, the second, if you look at teacher qualifications, all the states we looked at, having a qualified B.Ed. teacher is a huge issue, right? And it's prescribed into the law. The third sort of area we looked at was accountability and transparency. Again, here we found that, look, there are no penalties for non-compliance other than derecognition. And so you violate teacher norms, we'll de-recognize you. So I think a graded scale needs to be put in place around this. And even if you look at, for example, inspection, which is a part of really accountability, right? So all these states had a provision for inspection that was built into their rules, where government officials verify a school's adherence to recognition norms. But the recognition norms are really only pertain to infra and teacher qualification. So even if a school is actually focusing on quality, they're not likely to be recognized for that effort. And even if we zoom out, you know, we found that in general, there were some policies that had no relation to quality. So for example, in Uttar Pradesh, all private schools are required to have their buildings painted white and repainted every 2 years. In Haryana, all private schools are required to have a veranda in every room. You know, what we really found, you know, from all, and this work is still underway, and you know, we're going to share this work more widely, but is that there's significant differences across states, and therefore some sort of approach needs to be found for states to learn from each other and also root the model regulations in some under some principles. So we are, our goal now after this work is actually to engage with a couple of state governments. In fact, we've got one state government who's, you know, who's agreed to engage with us on really let's, based on this analysis, based on regulations across different states, we can even look at other sectors and then and really try and develop a sort of a model to be regulations. And what we, and in order to do that, we tried to lay out what would the principles and goals of this regulation be, because you have to define the goals, then you will sort of interpret and define policies. So some of the goals we put out, and I think it'll be good even to get thoughts from this group. So one we've laid out is really one principle goal would be to enable better entrepreneurs to enter the market, or you know, high quality entrepreneurs to enter the market. Second goal we've laid out is really high, allow quality schools freedom in their day-to-day functioning in exchange for or linked to transparency. A third goal we're putting is the regulation should be framed in a way that allow better schools to expand. And lastly, you know, our last goal is really that private schools should be accountable and transparent to the community. So what we are, again, like I said, our goal is really put these goals, put these principles, and then work with the current regulatory frameworks to try and implement them. And of course, we'll need to be pragmatic. I think the last thing we want to do is lay out rules and regulations which again are not going to be implemented. So I think the, some of those, you know, really tough problems around teacher qualifications, I think we need to face them. So I think I'm going to end there. Love to sort of hear from you, get thoughts around some of this work. I think people in this room feel what I mentioned here. They may have countless examples of when they are facing the brunt of the current regulatory framework. Thank you.